Welcome to our Living Word Home Church service. I hope you're doing well. I'm Pastor Benny, and I just want to welcome you here today. If you're joining us for the first time, thank you for being a part of this time with us as we learn and grow in God's Word together. Amen. Well, before we get started, we are going to be talking about our new series, again, Having a Lasting Peace. You know, and today's theme is going to be focused on, again, the myth of mental illness, mental health. You know, that's a topic that is really sensitive. And so we're just going to bow our heads and pray first. Amen. Let's just enter the Lord's presence. Father, we thank you for your promises or your word that you will not be returned void, that it will truly have its way in us, Lord. So we thank you for your divine appointment. We thank you for guiding us and preparing our heart, mind, soul, and spirit to receive all that you have for us in the mighty name of Jesus. And all the saints said, amen and amen. Folks, the myth of mental illness. For years, it's been said that it was going to get out of control. You know, the pharmaceutical companies are just getting ridiculously rich, stupid rich off of people's lives who are struggling with the mental illness. You know, how would you even know, first of all, if someone is struggling with mental health unless you see them homeless and living in the streets? Right? The truth is that most who struggle look healthy, living the day to day at work, in their marriages. You know, looking good on the outside, but on the inside, there's a panic. Overwhelmed with too much. Can't seem to get on top of it. Can't seem to get over it. You know, folks, the reality is you need help, but due to the stigma, the shame, the embarrassment, they won't get help. They say, I'm a Christian. I'm a pastor. How can I be struggling with that? Think about the things we say to avoid and due to our pride, due to the stigmas that are out there. Maybe if you're listening, you know someone. Or you know someone that you can relate to who feels depressed, anxious, stressed, wore down. Believe me, you're not alone. I want you to turn your Bible to the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, 24, the easy read version. It says, I pray that God will help you to be completely good, as his people should be. He is the one who gives us peace in our minds. And I pray that he will take care of you in every way, in your spirit, in your soul, and in your body. Then you will not be guilty of anything that is bad when our Lord Jesus Christ returns. I want you to take time during your week and read that scripture verse. I want you to break it down for yourself. It is God's intention that we have peace, folks. It is God's plan for us. He doesn't want us to struggle. He doesn't want us to have battles with, you know, our mental health. His peace. He wants his peace in every area of our life. For believers, God is our peace. But there are a lot of churches out there that may, although they believe in God's peace, don't believe that believers should struggle with mental health. That we shouldn't even be talking about it. Mental health, folks. Say it. Because all we need is to come to Jesus. That's what they believe. Let's not talk about mental health, because all we need is Jesus. And he fixes everything. It's true that Jesus saved us and we are redeemed and filled with the Holy Spirit when we believe. No doubt. He even works out all things for good to those who love him. All that is true. True, but incomplete. Just because we saved doesn't mean it fixes every area of our lives. Some areas have to be worked on. It's not instant. That should have been an ouch moment, right? It is not instant. Instant coffee, instant oatmeal. It's not instant. When Jesus saved me, he woke up the spiritual abs in me. Since then, I've been trying to work on a six-pack. I'm not talking about a physical six-pack, but the spiritual one, of course. We have been born again and have made some improvements. Maybe doing better with your, you know, again, what comes out of your mouth. Not cursing. You know, got a lot thinner around the waist. Better credit score, whatever it is, we experienced some gradual change. But just because we are Christian doesn't mean it's instantly done. When we talk about mental health, we are talking about our emotional, psychological, and sociological well-being, folks. They are things that are biological, sociologically, theologically, and emotionally ingrained in us. I hope you took that all in right now. A lot of stuff, we're talking about a lot of generational junk that impacts most of our areas in life. We might not even be aware of those emotional, psychological junk. They affect how we think, feel, and act. That's why we need to learn how to handle stress, how to relate, make choices, and bounce back from difficulties. We need to learn that. A lot of times that doesn't come naturally. It doesn't come naturally to many of us who have neglected our responsibilities because of misunderstanding the myth of mental health. Or because we lack the disciplines. Just the other day, I had a conversation with someone. No doubt that they love the Lord. In our discussion, this topic came up. You know, they asked, why is it that if I trust God, why would they be struggling with these battles? He referring to depression, of course, the mental stress. And I told him there can be so many different reasons. They could be coming from an emotional, psychological, or sociological trigger that we may not even be aware of. There can be things that are already habitual, we have already accepted as our norm, which means we could be doing a lot of good things, but are unaware of the unhealthy things that we consider normal. We can even think we have forgiven someone and still be holding on to resentment. We can want to believe one thing, but the actuality is something else. Which, again, causes mental stress. We wouldn't even think it would be, it would be having a negative effect on us. I remember when I was, when my kids were very young, and my youngest was about 5 years old, and out of the blue, he just wanted a hug. He wanted to hug me. And spontaneously, out of nowhere, he just came towards me, and I used my hands to like brush him off. You know, I wasn't even aware of that, that I was even doing that. You know, but my wife at the time said, you see, you can't even hug your son. Sometimes there are things that are there from your upbringing, from your culture, that you're not even aware of. You see, I was clueless. But that was a wake-up call. I wasn't aware that until that it was brought up at that moment, I knew that I had to make some changes. How could I be a loving, giving man of God if I couldn't even hug my kids, my children? Not intentional, of course. I just never got it as a kid. It was culturally ingrained in me. There were a lot that I was unaware of. Folks, there is a lot of things out there that we have to acknowledge before we can actually be free from these generational curses, insecurities, fears, traumas, depression, and the list goes on. The Bible tells us about the renewing of our minds. Yeah, again, what is that? Again, sometimes we take that and we just brush it off. There are a lot of things right now that God started to bring to light as I sought the peace of God, a lasting peace, which comes from an intimate relationship with God. I want you to turn your Bibles right now to the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 2, the NIV version. He said, "Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. So we won't be able to see nothing if we don't get ourselves right. We can't settle for just knowing and believing him, but seeking and knocking until that door is open. It is the only way to attain a lasting peace. That peace that God talks about, the peace of God that helps us to endure and persevere. So let's just talk about right now the two mental health myths, right? Myth number one, Christians shouldn't battle with anxiety, depression, or burnout. Here, we tend to label that as not having enough faith. You know, that is your fault. Not because you're not praying enough, because you are sinning. Those are a lot of the labels that are given when it comes to that. Folks, you can love Jesus and still be fighting depression. You can faithfully read God's word and battle anxiety. Attend church, tithe, serve, and struggle to overcome trauma. There are things that are out there, out of our control even, like chemical imbalances, hormonal changes, and many other things that could be happening in our psychic, in our bodies, that we can't even explain. But that doesn't change the fact. Doesn't mean that you don't have the victory over it. Because we do. We do. Elijah, one of the heroes of the Bible, constantly showed God's power displayed in his weaknesses. You know, one time he was so depressed that he wanted to die. I mean, let's just read a little bit of this. I want you to turn your Bible to 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 36 through 38, the easy read version. The time came for the evening offering. Then God's prophet Elijah came to the front of the altar. He prayed, "Lord, you are the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Show people clearly today that you are the God who rules over Israel. Show that I am your servant." He says, "Show that I have done all these things because you commanded me to do them. Please answer me, Lord. Answer me so that these people will know that you, Lord, are the true God. They will know that you have caused them to turn back to serve you again." Then the Lord sent fire from above, burned the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, the dirt. It made all the water in the hole around the altar disappear. I mean, you really got to read that story to understand what was taking place here. But the point of what I'm bringing the story is to show you how God was using Elijah. And after he uses him in this way, think about this a minute. After using him to do all of this, God gave Elijah abilities to outrun a horse. Sounds ridiculous, right? So let's read it. 1 Kings 18, verse 46, the easy read version. It said, "Then the Lord gave Elijah special power. Elijah tied the rope into his belt and he ran all the way to Jezreel. And Ahab followed him." Mind you, Ahab was on a horse. After God was doing all this with Elijah, you know, after all God does in his life, I mean, 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4, the easy read version. It says, "Then Elijah went into the desert by himself. He traveled for about a day. He found a small tree there and he sat down under it. He prayed that he might die. He said, 'Lord, I had enough trouble. Take my life from me.' He said, 'It's no better for me here than to be with my dead ancestors.'" What do you hear? Elijah was struggling, depressed. This is the same Elijah that raised the kid from the dead. And he wasn't the only one who battled these thoughts. David, with despair. Jeremiah, who is known as the weeping prophet. Folks, we struggle with loneliness, insecurities. You feel like you've been cursed the day you were born. Or maybe you're struggling mentally in other areas. It doesn't mean you are not a good Christian. Just human. Don't think that you must always be cheerful and positive. Grief and depression takes time to heal. When we don't give it the time, we end up suppressing it. Trying to avoid it, hiding it. But if we go without dealing with it, it will cause deep roots. See, sometimes we think we have this under control. We take matters into our own hand. We're in denial because we thinking that it's gonna go away if we ignore it. Or we try finding other ways to medicate, to fill in that void, and it make things even worse. We need to expose it. Address those issues. Share it. Put it to the light. No matter how low we feel, we can always bring our problems to God and express our pain. And I want to tell you about the psalmist in the book of Psalm 88. It tells us that although there are times when everything bad gets even worse, God is able. So you can go to him and you can know that in those dark moments. See, I know how dark it can get sometimes in those dark moments. So I want you to turn your Bible to the book of Psalm 88, 1 through 5, the easy read version. Listen to this. Lord, you are the God who rescues me. I call out to you in the day and I pray for help at night. Please listen to my prayer. I am calling to you for help. There is a lot of trouble in my life. I feel that I am near to death. People see me as if I am already in the grave. I feel completely helpless. I am the same as people who have died. Their bodies already lie in their grave. You do not remember them anymore. You cannot use your power to help them. Wow, that doesn't sound too positive, right? But it's a cry. Remember, just because you feel you are in the dark place, it doesn't mean that you're not a good Christian. It just means we might need more of God, more sleep, more community, more better friends. Your feelings might be real, but not necessarily true. Folks, take it to God. You hear me? Take it to God. He'll make a way. He'll make someone. Or he'll send someone to us. Like when God sent Elijah to the widow woman whose son ended up dying and Elijah ends up resurrecting him. You can find that in 1 Kings chapter 17. You ever felt worried or depressed that you couldn't even sleep? Well, that's the worst. I remember having one of those triple storms type of seasons in my life. I felt like I was going to lose my house. The city was hitting me with all these fines. I couldn't pay. I had no money. I couldn't get a loan from a bank. The church was going through a major crisis I was unprepared for. And to top it off, I was mentally exhausted. So Psalm 88 was really meek. So let's read it a minute. Psalm 88, verse 13 to 18, the easy read version. He said, but as for me, Lord, I call to you for help. Every morning I pray to you, Lord, why do you throw me out? Why do you turn away from me? Since I was young, I have been in pain. I have always been near to death. You have caused bad troubles to frighten me so that I feel helpless. Your anger is too much for me. You are attacking me and destroying me. The troubles that you send are all around me, like a flood of deep water. They come very near to me on every side. You cause my friends and my neighbors to stay away from me. All that I have near to me is darkness. Ever felt like that? Not pleasant to have to go through moments like that. As you can see, God made a way. He always makes a way. He makes a way where there is no way. He's our way. He's the only way. He's our only way, folks. Mental health starts with God. Say it. Mental health starts with God. Remember, if you struggle or are struggling with some form of mental illness or stress, it doesn't mean that you're not a good Christian. Just means that you're human. So myth number one says Christians shouldn't struggle with mental health. Myth number two is that God doesn't care about mental health. Really. God is never too busy for us, folks, or have bigger problems not to care about ours. God is not afraid of our honesty. That's why I like to read Psalm 88. You might want to read the whole thing. If you hurt, he hurts. Folks, when my kids go through stuff, I go through stuff, and I pray. If you're breaking down, call an elder, call a pastor, call a counselor, call on the Lord. Why let your pride take you down a rabbit hole? Stop trying to look for your own way out. Psalm number 4, chapter 4, verse 2, easy read version. Tell me this, you people, how long will you refuse to respect me? How long will you love stupid ideas? How long will you agree with lies? You might want to read your own translation, but that's what it says in the easy read. In other words, why do you reject his help, his love? We so often go back to our old ways of living, what we are comfortable with, our dysfunction, like a dog going back to its vomit. Then you read Psalm 4, 3, the Amplified version. He says, but know that the Lord has set apart for himself and dealt wonderfully with the godly man, the one of honorable character and moral courage, the one who does right. The Lord hears and responds when I call to him. I was going to say when we call to him. He responds. He makes a way. He answers when we call, folks. Even when we feel confused, lost, not thinking clearly, mentally drained, depressed, it doesn't matter what it is, God still listens to our prayers. Sometimes we think that God will not, but not true. Mental health can feel like a strong, mighty strong storm. Or like being in a dark cave. Call on the living God who will answer you when you call. Remember, getting help isn't a sign of weakness. It's a sign of wisdom. This is about having peace regardless of our circumstances. With the peace that surpasses human understanding, as the word says. How do we get that peace? Well, more intimacy with God. That's right. Being more intimate with God gives us the peace we need. Doesn't matter where we're at. This is about having peace regardless of the circumstances. With the peace that surpasses even our own human understanding. I want you to turn your Bible to the book of Matthew chapter 22 verse 37, the NIV. Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. You might want to take that scripture verse. You might want to saute it. You want to break it down. You want to really understand what that means and how to get that done, because that is the solution. Knowing that God loves us gives us all the peace we need. So regardless of how we feel, we know we are secure. Romans chapter 8, verse 35, the NIV version. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Who? Nothing can separate us, not even nothing. Romans 8:38, the NIV. Neither height nor depth, nor anything else on all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. Folks, holding on to the truth, that truth, when we face those debilitating battles, that we don't rely on the feelings, but on the truth. Those are the things we need to sort of hold on to in order to overcome some of these battles. We, of course, have to discipline ourselves and to break these habitual patterns that we have become so accustomed to. You know, the dysfunction that has become normal. You know, whether it's due to trauma, culture, upbringing, chemical imbalances, or choices due to a combination of all these things. We have to fix our eyes on Jesus. Isaiah 26:3, the Amplified Version. You will keep in perfect and constant peace the one whose mind is steadfast, that is committed and focused on you in both inclination and character, because he trusts and takes refuge in you with hope and confident expectation. Folks, let's put it all on him, on the Lord. You'll see the difference. We are not talking about just occasional peace, momentarily or occasional peace, folks. That's not what we're talking about here. But shalom, peace, wholeness. Remember, the world's definition of peace is absence of conflict. Irrationally, because we're going to always have some form of conflict. With God, we can never, well, let me put this again. With God, we can know perfect peace. That regardless of the problems, the troubles, the struggles we're having, because of our commitment and devotion to him, our whole attitude is steady and stable. Because we know that we are supported by God's unchanging love and power. Turn to Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, 7, the Amplified Version. It says, do not be anxious or worried about anything, but in everything, every circumstance and situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, continue to make your specific requests known to God, and the peace of God, that peace which assures the heart, that peace which transcends all understanding, that peace which stands guard over your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus, is yours. You might want to read that. You might want to hold on to that. Folks, we have the victory. He has given it to us. But we have to understand that when we go to him, it's knowing him. It's having that intimate relationship that you know him so well that you can go to him and he'll answer. Ali Hasbi was a man in the 1800s. He wrote that the only way in which we can gather and keep collecting our distracted minds and our roaming thoughts is to center them about Jesus Christ. So he says, so let Christ lay hold of, attract, captivate, and gather about himself all our interests. Then our sessions of prayer will become real meetings with God, and the peace of God will descend with healing and blessings upon my distracted soul. Love that. Paul tells us, based on the harmonialized relationship between him and God, you know, he had that kind of intimate relationship with God, harmonized. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 9, the NLT version, he says, keep putting into practice all that you learn and receive from me. He says, everything you heard me from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. He was referring to that relationship he had with the Father, with Jesus. Folks, nothing is going to happen overnight. So instead of relying on your own strength, your own understanding, doing the same old things that don't work, won't ever work, stop going around in circles. Let's go to the source of mental health, which is Jesus. Listen to what Jesus says. John chapter 14, verse 27, the NIV version. He said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give. I do not give you as the world gives. He said, do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. For God is our source and strength. We have everything we need to do. Everything he calls us to do. Draw nearer to him. Be more intimate with him. But what does he leave us? He leaves us the Holy Spirit. The peace he leaves us is the Spirit. But how can we do that? Let's just look at some things we can do. Number one thing we can do. Trust in his promises, not your feelings. Number one. Trust in his promises, not your feelings. These are just a few things to do that are practical things. Seek spiritual counsel. It's not a weakness, but a strength. Don't make major decisions without counsel when you're going through those moments. Learn to wait on the Lord for clarity. Pray more. Five, spend more time with God and less time stressing. Trying to find ways to medicate, to avoid. Six, set times. Well, set a time frame to accomplish new habits and breaking the old ones. Journal. Seven, journal your progress. These are things that we can do to start learning that because we can't rely on what we feel in the moments that we go through stresses, pain. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, the MSG version. He says, everything that goes into a life of pleasing God has been miraculously given to us by getting to know personally and intimately the one who invites us to God. The best invitation we ever received, we were also given absolutely terrific promises to pass on to you. Your tickets to participation in the life of God after you turn your back on a world corrupted by lust. 2 Peter, you might want to read that. Verse 1, the MSG version. Find your other versions that you like to read. We have to be willing to get rid of and let go of the things that hold us, hold on to the things that hold us back, keep holding us back. What are those things that keep holding us back? We got to get rid of those things and hold on to what keeps us holding us. And let's look for Jesus in this perspective. When we do, When I said this, and I wanted to say, okay, God has given us a perspective, right? He's given us what we need, all the resources to be able to overcome the battles. There are things we have to realize that we're holding on to that keeps us from moving forward. Jesus says, my peace I give to you, not a peace. My peace. My peace means what? Think about it. When did he promise his peace? I mean, this could be an ouch moment, but peace isn't found. Say that. Peace isn't found. My peace. Think about that. When he promised, when did he promise his peace? See? Did he promise absence of problems? Or the presence of God? See? He promised the Holy Spirit that is working in our lives. It's a deep and lasting peace. It is constant. Constant peace. When children are rebelling. You see? When you hear bad news. Peace when you're losing a job or lost a job. Peace when the marriages are struggling. When money is tight. See? Peace of God. The world can't take that away. The world can't give it. And let's close with 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, 24, the NIV version. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's hold on to the promise he gave us, folks. Let's just take a minute and pray right now. If you're struggling with something, Father, we just thank you right now, Lord, that, Lord, you are the God of the impossible. You're the God that loves us, Lord. You're the God that makes a way where doesn't seem to be a way. Nothing is impossible for you to do, Lord. It doesn't matter what it is. So we ask you to search our heart, my soul, and spirit. Empower us with your divine wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Set us free this day, Lord, in understanding the blessings that you have provided us. The opportunity to have you in us, Lord, giving us everything we need because we can trust in you. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. And all the saints said, amen and amen. Well, this went a little long today, but join us in our Q&A discussion as we're going to discuss a few points of what we have just heard. So thank you for being a part of it. Follow us on livingword.nyc. And remember, God is good all the time. God is good. Take care. God bless.